So during the cleansing process, when you're following an actual structure of detoxification, different cleanses, different foods, different exercises, you're going to have these experiences, especially in the beginning, when your body starts to expel things. You might run a fever. It's important to trust that because you're following the correct lifestyle and your guidance is accurate, that what you're doing is supposed to be happening, and so you have to try to trust in it. The biggest thing that stops our progress when we try to heal ourselves is our fear. And the fear comes because of a lack of knowledge. Knowledge removes our fear, because fear is often from the unknown. If you experienced a pain in your body and you didn't know what it was, you would have fear about it, and you'd go find somebody who had knowledge about it. Or you would try to ignore it, because some people respond to fear by suppressing it, by going into greater unconsciousness. Now, if you had that same pain in your body and you already had the information about what it was about, you would not have any fear. You would know exactly what to do, and you would do what is effective to remove the pain. So fear is not necessary when bad things, quote-unquote bad things, happen. Fear is a response to not having the information or the knowledge to do what is right to change our situation. So fear can empower us to change, or it can cause us to freeze up. So as we detoxify, if we understand why it is happening, then we can do things that increase the detoxification to make the pain or the suffering shorter. This includes diet, this includes maybe specific exercises, or other physical things. A great way to reduce the amount of time spent detoxifying is an enema. An enema is something you can buy on your own. It involves putting clean water, recommended that we use distilled water, into a bucket with a tube, and the tube is inserted into the anus so that the water can go up the intestines and wash everything out. The reason why we expel things through our nose or our mouth is often because the other channels are blocked. The biggest channel to expel our toxins is our intestines. That's where the toxins are best served. That's where the toxins are best removed from. That's where they're supposed to go. Gravity carries them down and out. When the downward area is blocked, then the body has to push them out somewhere else. Now, this is not black and white, because some toxins are in your skin and they're best expelled through sweat. Some toxins are in your lungs, they're best expelled through coughing. But the primary detoxification route is the intestines. This is why it's commonly taught that when we start detoxifying, like doing cleanses and herbs, that the intestines must be done first. That's the tubes. We have to have them open so that all the other organs can dump their waste into the intestines to be removed. That's why we begin with colon flushes, with herbs to break down the waste products along the walls of our intestines. Enemas will wash away anything that's already broken down, and also the enema water will help to soften anything that's hardened, the hardened waste. And so we hold the water inside of ourselves for at maximum 20 minutes. But in the beginning, it may be 5 minutes, because we're not used to having water, a lack of muscle control. The idea is that water is not supposed to be in the intestines, the large intestines. Okay, so in the stomach, everything is turned into a soup. Everything's, you chew it up, you create it into mush, it becomes like a soup. When you vomit, it's all liquidy, it's soupy. So it's made into a soup in the stomach. Then it passes into the small intestines. In that soup, the body is best able to extract the vitamins and minerals and nutrients that it needs from the food. The small intestines absorb our nutrition. Then the waste products go down into the large intestines. The large intestines draw the water out of the food to turn that soup into hard stool. And then the stool can be pushed out of our body. When we do an enema, we put a large amount of water in our intestines, more than what the body naturally has during digestion. It's more than what the body can absorb through the intestinal walls. This creates a reaction in the body where the body wants to push out the water, because too much water in the intestines can cause health problems. Okay? When we have diarrhea, that's too much water in the intestines. The body doesn't want all that water in there. And the body's mechanism of absorbing the water through the intestines is blocked in some way when we have diarrhea. So during an enema, we're naturally putting a lot of water in the intestines. The body wants to expel the water out of the intestines. As we do that, it carries the waste products out with it. So enemas should not be used for a long period of time because they're imbalancing to the body, because they interfere with how the body naturally wants to work. But we've learned how to use the enema effectively to help the detoxification process by carrying away the waste products more quickly. Okay, and so medicine is like that in many ways. For example, when we had the cold and we had the mucus, that's a cold and damp substance. We introduced hot foods or hot and warming things, the chicken soup, the ginger tea. You can also do cayenne pepper, hot peppers and things in liquid, that helps to expel it as well. So we do the opposite in order to help support the healing process. The intestines don't want that much water in it. We put the water in it. That's another form that's in the opposite direction. It imbalances it, but that helps to remove the toxic material. So sometimes doing the opposite helps to bring us back into balance. And sometimes doing the opposite will push us out of balance. It depends when we're using what methods. The body wants to detoxify. When the body's too weak, it will not detoxify until the toxins reach such a large amount that we have a healing crisis. That's a disease. That is a normal cold or flu. My experience is we do not catch colds. We create them. We do not get sick, we create the sickness. What we have been doing in our lives have been weakening our immune system and putting more toxins within us. Eventually the body is forced to try to expel it. And when the body expels the waste, that's called a cold or a flu, or when the body develops cancer and tries to expel it through the skin or through blood, things like that, then that's another type of healing crisis. We've created it. Through our wrong living, we've created it. It does not come from outside of us. Now, I shouldn't say that, because even our food comes from outside of us. But it's that it doesn't attack us. Modern Western medicine is what I call a military medicine. All of our healing tactics are like missiles and bombs or knives. So if an organ is causing us a problem, we kill it. We cut it out. If we have a cold or a flu, we take a pill that acts like a bomb, and it destroys everything. An antibiotic is going to destroy all bacteria. Biotic means life. Bio. Biotic. Probiotic is pro-life. Those little probiotic pills or probiotics in food, they are bacteria, healthy bacteria that supports life. Antibiotic is against life. That's exactly what the word means. It's against life. And so it's a bomb that we put in our body that destroys the living bacteria. It doesn't destroy our cells because it's not strong enough, but it destroys the bacteria because they're very small microorganisms. We have to have bacteria in our body. It's in our blood. It's in our organs. The bacteria is what digests the food. It's a necessary part of it. So if you take an antibiotic, afterwards, you have to take a series of probiotics. These are specifically grown bacteria to restore that which has been killed. And so I think of antibiotics like an atomic bomb. It's a weak atomic bomb. It destroys everything in its tracks. And then we have to rebuild after it. Okay. So modern Western medicine has been created by the culture that has created the most wars in the history of the world. Good old United States of America, right? So our medicine is naturally going to be like how we act. A culture that creates peace is going to do practices, follow diets, use medicine that tries to create peace and balance in the body. India historically has been one of the most peaceful countries. Now, granted, in modern times, they've had their own conflicts, you know, with England and within themselves and different religious systems. But the ancient medicine of India has been historically known to come from the most prosperous country in the world. Thousands of years ago, India had all the wealth, had all the culture, all the art. They were a very prosperous country. And so naturally, their knowledge would come from a prosperous, balanced community like that. We have a similar aspect with China. China was more natural. They were very much in harmony with nature. They had the Confucians and the Taoists who lived in nature and studied the natural ways. So their medicine is going to be in harmony with nature. Now we have the West, which has always been in competition against themselves. Science is competing. Science against religion. Country against country. War against war. And so we have naturally a medicine that is very aggressive and warlike. It's not to say it's not effective. It's effective for certain things, but it also has its drawbacks. And so after every war, you have to clean up stuff. You know, sometimes it helps to destroy something very quick, like a cancer. It helps to destroy it very quickly, and then we have to rebuild afterwards. However, in my experience, it is wiser to learn how to not create the cancer in the beginning, to not create the illness in the beginning. So during these natural healing approaches, you are encouraging the body to detoxify. You're letting the body fight its own battles, and you're supporting the body to be on the winning side. So you're supporting the body to remove the toxins. This way it's not aggressive. This way you're trusting the body's intelligence. You're working in harmony with your body. So you're creating greater health as you go forward. And so these are called healing crises. Some are controlled, some are uncontrolled. Or they're called detox reactions. You want to encourage them. And the idea is that if they're happening when you're doing the right thing, you can be certain that your body's removing the toxins the right way. The healing crises should only last for a short period of time. They should not be prolonged. Disease lasts for a long period of time. The healing crises last for a short period of time. That's one way you can tell the difference. If you're doing right living and you know you're following a good system, then the healing crisis is a good thing and not a bad thing. However, we have to be very, very careful because a lot of modern day nutritional programs are not balanced and they're not created correctly. And so sometimes people think they're having healing crisis, but they've been having it for 2 years. And the teacher says, oh, your body's still detoxifying. And the person's getting weaker and weaker and weaker because they're missing important things that their body needs. And so there's I've seen it a lot. There's a very, very common misunderstanding that nutrition teachers, or healing gurus, they will say that if you're having detox, it has to be because your body's, if you're having health problems, your body's detoxifying. You know, my system is not failed. My system is right. And they will stand behind their system in spite of the actual evidence because they have pride, because they have self-interest in their system. They make money, they make their livelihood based upon their ideas being correct. And it is too difficult for a human being to accept that their ideas are wrong when it threatens their own survival. This is the difference between science and business. I've chosen to try to study science of nutrition and not businesses. There's a lot of fads, there's a lot of businesses, a lot of books, all these things, and they're most cases, they're incomplete. I found a few teachers who've been looked at it like science, and science was their priority. They've had businesses come and go and fail, but they always tried to do the right thing. They always tried to honor the science. And so they got into legal trouble sometimes because they were, you know, saying that, you know, they were going against the society. You know, they were saying, you know, eat food and fast and do these things, and they were producing good results, whereas a business person would have changed their science to make their business succeed. But a scientist will let their business fail to keep the science growing. Just priorities there. So if you are having healing issues, you know, you want to follow something good, a good diet, you can study Ayurveda and Chinese medicine, try to find reputable teachers like textbooks and not recipe books. I've seen way too many recipe books saying that they're Chinese medicine Ayurveda and have absolutely nothing to do with them, and the recipes are composed in ways that are against the principles of these two forms of medicine?